Hello everyone, this is video number 10 in my Manners for Kids series, and today this video is for any parent who is struggling with getting their child to use their utensils and not their hands. Okay, so I'm going to approach this in a way which I explain three reasons why your child may be using their hands instead of their utensils, and then some solutions to how to try to fix those problems depending on the reason, and then I'm going to give you some tips and some tools to try to encourage your child to use their utensils and not their hands. Okay, so the first reason why your child may be using their hands and not their utensils is because of their age. So children until a certain age really do struggle with using utensils. It's a small motor skill development thing, but in addition to that, I mean, it's not easy necessarily to get food up to your mouth on the fork without it falling off. I mean, these are all control, small motor skill things. So it may be the age. So what I would suggest is making sure that one, the pieces are really cut small enough that it's easy for them to get it on the fork or the spoon, and that there's a lot of space on the plate for them to maneuver the fork and the spoon around in order to get the food onto it and into the mouth, because it is challenging for them. So why I think it's important that we leave enough space is we don't want this to get frustrating for your child. If your child gets frustrated with it, they're just gonna say, forget it, this fork, knife thing, spoon is just a waste of time. I'm just gonna use my hands because it's a lot easier. Some people like to maybe say that it's because they're lazy, but I don't think it is because they're lazy. I just think it's because it's easier. So why wouldn't we do what's easier? So that leads me to my second point. Maybe your child doesn't understand why table manners are so important. I mean, if it's so much easier just to use your hands, why do you want them to use a fork, knife, and spoon? So again, this is very cultural. So I'm speaking to anybody out there that wants your child to use a fork, knife, and spoon. If in your culture you do not use fork, knives, or spoons, or depending on the dish you're eating, you use something else, then this is a totally different topic. I'm speaking only to those parents who really want to encourage their child to use a fork, knife, and spoon because it is, for example, in their culture to use a fork, knife, and spoon. So if you want your child to use a fork, knife, and spoon, please make sure that they understand why you want them to use it. It's something that mommy and daddy learned how to do. It's part of your culture and a very important part because it shows that you are polite. It shows that you are well-mannered. Your older brother or sister learned how to do it. It's kind of one of those skills. It's a life skill that you need to learn how to use. So really try to explain to them in ways in which they will understand that, you know, like mommy and daddy not just think it's important, but mommy and daddy also learn, just like I learned how to do math, for example, or something else that they really like. So for example, like riding a bike. That's a great one. So if your child is at the age, which is about this age, where they're learning how to ride a bike, just say, look, like you learned how to ride a bike, it was really important to do that because it's important to learn how to ride a bike. So this is also important to learn how to use your fork, knife, and spoon properly because it's part of growing up. It's part of becoming a big kid. You need to learn how to do it just like mommy and daddy did, or maybe the big brother did. So that is tip number two. Tip number three. Okay, so for any of those parents out there that maybe are questioning if your child is not using their fork, knife, and spoon and they're using their hands instead because they want to maybe irritate you a little bit or get under your skin, not that our angels would ever do that, but if you think it's because they're just trying to be a little cheeky, for example, my suggestion would be to try to ignore the behavior in the sense of just instill, please use your fork, knife, and spoon. Period. Just keep on saying it over and over again. Try not to let the frustration get to you if you think your child is trying to push your buttons, because if they don't see a response from you besides just reminding them over and over again to do it, then they'll just stop doing it because it's not going to be worth their time. Like we've seen throughout when they've done this before. And I know you know what I'm talking about. If you don't think that's going to be enough because you think your child is really, I mean, they've really will stick with it, then this is what I would suggest because you want to make it more valuable to them. So here are my tips and a couple of tools that you can use. Okay, so the first one that I would suggest using is you can make this into a game. So anytime you can make a new skill, adoption of a new skill into a game, the more likely your child is going to actually do it and be interested in doing it. So I have a couple different games. The first one is one I've already highlighted in a different video, which is, and it does work, it's tried and tested. I use it growing up, my parents use it with us. I use it with my daughter, so I know this works. Please choose one of these games depending on your parenting style. So if you don't believe in, for example, you know, monetary reasons like giving money to your children, then don't use this one. But there are other ones that I can give examples. So this is the game. So you have a stack of coins. I have dirham here, and If your child, you can either do one of two things. Either you take them away or you give them. So you can keep them on your side, and every time you see your child doing something positive, so it's positive reinforcement, you give them a coin. And at the end of the meal, they see how many coins they have left. So for example, using their utensils, not using their hands. At the end, if you see how many coins they have, and then at the end of the meal, they get to keep those coins, you write them down, and then the next meal they add to it. And at the end of the week, they'll have enough, maybe they can buy something. You can use a dirham, you can use, you know, 50 fizzles instead if you want. You don't have to use a full, it's up to you. You can use whatever amount you want. You can do that. If you're more of the takeaway concept, you can leave them in front of the child, stacked, and then every time you see them make a mistake, you say, oh, we have to take it away. If you have more than one child, you can make it a competition to see who has more at the end. So you make it like, who is the one that had the best table manners today? And then they keep the coins again at the end. Okay. So the second game, to make this interesting, is you can do something which I did, which is like have a family, I'm trying to look for it, here it is. Okay, so you can have a family chart. So I have here your table manners matter chart. I put it up here as well. Okay, in this chart, you can have different manners that you would like your child to master. So like, for example, napkin on the lap, using your utensils and not your fingers, asking to pass something instead of just reaching for it. And if they use please and thank you, it's even a more of a bonus. And then chewing with your mouth closed. And then the winner gets to have an extra dessert at the end of the week. The winner of this gets an extra dessert the next week, or they get to choose the meal, one meal for next week. So what the meal is, for example. So those are two really good ways to do it. Again, you can check out this chart. So each child, if you have one child, like, okay, great. Then you add up the total. And you can see, like, you have to have a certain number of points. So for example, like, if it's every day you can potentially have 1, 2, 3, 4 points, then you add the points here and then across. So you, like, you would have, you know, 28 points, for example, a maximum. So if they reach, let's say you could do a range like 20 to 25, they get this 20. You can really use whatever you want to make this work for you. If you have two children, it can be a competition. So for example, like one child, you write in one ink color and the other one the other ink color. At the end of the week, whoever has the most points gets to have an extra dessert the next week or gets to choose the meal for next week. And then the last tip that I have is to make a table mat. So you'll see here, Sabine's table mat. You can make your own table mat. And what you can do is you can design it however. So Sabine likes this design. It's pink, it's a little bit girly, but there's a dragon. The dragon's name is Matches. And Matches wants to stay sleeping. And we want to keep Matches sleeping by having good table manners. And so in that little box you'll see there, I wrote using our fork. Okay, so you can, with a pen, so you can get this laminated and you can write with a pen whatever it is that week that you want them to focus on, because if we don't use that, then maybe Matches wakes up and we don't want Matches to wake up. So you make it kind of like a fun game for the kids so they understand it more like play and less like, you know, etiquette and manners, which maybe could be a little bit overwhelming or maybe a little boring to them. So those are my tips and tricks and tools and for understanding why your child maybe is using their hands instead of using their utensils. I hope it was helpful. Please give me your feedback as always, and please check out the other videos in my Manners for Kids.